families, and welcome back to the FB First Family Ministry Podcast, where our goal is equipping families to navigate life with God's truth. I'm Pastor Jonathan, and today we're joined with Pastor Gabe, Aaron, and a special guest, Pastor Josh Wood. Pastor Josh has been in family ministry for 18 years, has four awesome kids of his own, and has much experience when it comes to a child's spiritual development. Pastor Josh also has an amazing way of making things super fun and engaging. You will not want to miss any part of this conversation. Let's get into it.
Pastor Josh, welcome to the Family Ministry Podcast.
Hey, thank you. I'm glad to be here.
So good to have you here. So I know that we've been looking forward to this conversation for a while, and we're very excited to share this with you all today.
Yeah, there's a fun topic that we're getting into today, just talking about discipleship and discipleship through the lens of the gospel conversations that we can have with our kids and what is a good way to have that conversation and how do we talk about that, just getting into it.
Yeah. No, well, there's no greater topic. There's no greater conversation you can have with your children than about the gospel. Mm. And, and I'm sure we're going to dig into all this stuff, but there's so many different pieces of the gospel, and the gospel is so applicable to everything that you do with your kids. You can tie it back to Jesus. You can tie it back to his work on the cross and our need for him. And so literally the opportunities are limitless. We just got to make sure we're doing our due diligence by looking.
Yeah, absolutely. Love that. Love that. Today, we want to make sure that everything that we're doing is centered around the gospel. That's something that, in all of our conversations, we don't want it to be our words. We want it to be God's words. And so today we were drawn to the passage of Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 through 15. Where Jesus is sitting down and there's, a crowd around him. And it says in verse 13, the children were brought to him that he might lay his hands on them and pray. The disciples rebuked the people, but Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for such belongs the kingdom of heaven." And he laid his hands on them and went away. So some people might be like, well, why this passage? Of all the passages that we could talk about discipleship and sharing the gospel, we could go to the end of Matthew when Jesus gives the Great Commission, why would we use this passage right here? There's three things from it that I think, when I was doing my studies and stuff that I really thought, were brought out in this passage. Number one, we see people literally and parents literally bringing their kids to Jesus. Like, not just in the sense of leading them to salvation,
but physically
taking their kids and laying them on Jesus' lap and saying, "Please bless my child." Quite literally. Number two, we see that there's an opposition from the disciples. They thought that the kids were too young, or maybe they weren't mature enough to be with Jesus, or they were on the other end, we don't want to bother Jesus with these kids. They're kind of annoying. They talk a lot. They probably ask him a lot of questions. We don't want to, bog Jesus down with that unimportant stuff. But then the best thing that we see in the third aspect is we see Jesus bless the children, not because of what they themselves have done, but because of the humility, the innocence, the joy. They were like, "Here I am, a child of the king, sitting with the king, right there." And then, one thing I saw that was just really cool in Barnes' notes on this topic, he said, "All are fallen and all have a tendency to sin, and none but Jesus can save them." And that just really stood out to me, because the parents realized this, the kids realized this, there was nothing that they could do to save their kids, but they just brought them to Jesus. They were like, "Jesus, you're the one who's going to bless them. Please bless our children. We can't do it ourselves." Disciples were like, "Nah, fam, back up." And then Jesus was like, "No, let the little children come to me and don't forbid them. This is going to be my kingdom, and I'm going to be the one blessing them." So, man, I really think that that's just a good jumping point for our conversation.
Yeah, I think it's important because of, pardon me, the emphasis that it puts on the relationship as a child and how you set that foundation with Jesus when children are little,
right,
that they can grow from there. Versus if you're saying, "Well, you're not worthy, don't worry about this until you get older," what are we really telling them? What are they seeing from us? And I think it's just that's a great passage to dive into.
Yeah, definitely. So first off, kudos to the parents. Good job.
Yeah.
your job as a parent is to get your kids to Jesus in whatever way you can, however you can. And these parents, they didn't let society, they didn't let the expectations of what other people were putting on them stop them from doing that. They said, no, Jesus is in town and I'm taking my kids. We're going. And as parents, that's our job, is whatever we could do to get our kids to Jesus, or to get our kids to, into a place where they can meet Jesus, hear about Jesus, learn about Jesus. That's one of our most important things. So many times as parents, when we talk about discipleship and gospel conversations, we get this intimidation factor of, well, I don't know all the answers. And if I don't know all the answers, what if my kid asks me a question that I don't have the answer for? Yeah. And so we don't, it kind of freezes us and it stops us in our tracks, when really these parents didn't have any answers either. They didn't know what they were doing, except that Jesus was the one that their kids needed to meet. And so kudos to the parents going out of their way, going against society, going against social norms and expectations to get their kids to Jesus.
Yeah.
And here in America and in our world, we are so blessed to have the freedom to not just come to Jesus and to come to worship him, but to be able to bring our children and to be able to bring our kids, not just to church, but you talk about Christian media, you talk about music, you talk about books and all these different ways that we can introduce our children to Jesus. We don't have to have the answers. We just have to be willing to get out of ourselves, out of our own comfort zone, and take these kids there, because they're the ones that have all the questions. Jesus is the one that has all the answers. We just got to introduce them.
Right, so. Right. Love that. Pastor Gabe, what
no, it, thoughts? It's so true that, you know, culturally speaking, time-wise, yeah, they had no resources.
No.
Now, of course, they had Jesus, which is the best resource to have,
right?
The foundation itself. But for us, man, we're blessing this culture to have so many resources to be able to tap into. And I think, like Pastor Josh just said, it's just the intentionality behind us of being willing to bring our children, and honestly, being willing to read those books, right? Being willing to put those avenues that will help our kids to know Jesus and to trust in Jesus. So yeah, no, I love it. Love it.
I think something really stood out to me when you said, Jesus is in town. We're taking our kids to see him. Like, what if we treated, you know, bringing kids to Jesus the way that a lot of people bring their kids to see Santa or the Easter Bunny, right? Yeah. Where those opportunities are a couple of times a year. Well, you have an opportunity every day to bring your child to Jesus. And what if you had the same excitement and you put it on your calendar the way that you do when, you know, when you're bringing your kid and you're scheduling that appointment to go get the crying photo of your child? Right? Hopefully they're not crying when they come to church, or it doesn't even have to be that you're bringing them to church necessarily, but you're planning this time, you're intentionally bringing them to Jesus within the home. And that's, we've talked a lot about that in our last podcast even. So
yeah, I was so scared growing up of those, like the characters, whether it was at Disney or SeaWorld or anything, I would just get so scared of those characters. And it's like the intimidation of that, like that doesn't happen when they meet Jesus, because ultimately, you know, Jesus is, and we don't see that. We don't see, and the child was laid on Jesus's lap and they freaked out and they went crazy. We can lose us. And we don't see that. You know, we see there, Jesus brings a calm to them and whatnot, you know, that they wouldn't experience elsewhere. But yeah, you heard it here. Pastor Jonathan was freaked out by Winnie the Pooh.
But, you know, Miss Erin, you bring an interesting point as treating Jesus the way we would treat, you know, going to see Santa Claus or the Easter Bunny. I mean, I think about like waiting hours just for a picture, that may not happen, because I'm just being honest. Sometimes my son, he doesn't like the Easter Bunny. And, you know, I've been there where we waited 45 minutes for him to take a picture, for him to just get close enough to say, nope, it ain't happening, right? Right. But what if we had that same just endurance and resistance to bring our children to Jesus and say, no, we're going to, whatever we need to do, however long we need to wait, you're going to meet Jesus.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That's a great point. So the other thing I liken this to is, you know, like, you know, we have teenagers that, there's their local celebrity, their favorite person is coming to give concert. I know Taylor Swift was in our area a while back, and I heard tickets were going for like $1,500.
Yeah.
It's great, crazy stuff. But people will spend their entire life savings to go see a celebrity on stage for a couple hours. And Jesus is that person that, number one, he's worth all of that. if we wanted to go wait in line for an hour, or if we wanted to go spend $1,500 to meet Jesus face to face, he's worth every bit of it. But he doesn't require any of that. He breaks down all the walls. He breaks down all the barriers. He says, actually, no, I'm going to come to you, and I'm going to meet with you where you're at, instead of you having to somehow get good enough or get great enough to be with me. The other thing that I love about that passage, Pastor Jonathan, that you mentioned, is Jesus doesn't just meet with the children and bless the children. He then turns it around on the people and says, I'm telling you what, not only am I here for these kids, but unless you become like these kids, unless your faith is similar to the faith of this child, there's no way you're getting anywhere further than this earth. This earth is the closest to heaven you'll ever get, unless you have a faith like these children do.
Children.
And so when we look at that, Jesus's mindset wasn't just about, oh yeah, I'm here for kids too. Look, they're charity and we love them and
right.
We want a good spot for them. No, he looked at them and said, these are the example.
Right.
There's something that this child has that you need in your life. And if you don't learn how to humble yourself and learn from this child, then you're going to have a very difficult time learning and adapting to the other things that you're going to have to deal with in life, the other type of discipleship issues that you're going to have to conquer. And so a lot of times I'll look at my kids, and while I might get frustrated about things and frustrated about, you know, I'll wait an hour and they won't want to take the picture I wanted to take or whatever. But then I'll look at it and I'll say, but you know what? Does that really matter?
Yeah.
In the long run, in this grand scheme, does that really matter? What things really matter? And it's like when I get home and my children are excited to see me, like, dad, you're home. And they run into my arms. And it's like, that should be our mindset when we come to Jesus. I had a hard day. I had a long day. I finally get to go home. I had a little bit of time to rest. Maybe I get to open my Bible. I could spend some time in prayer, conversing with my wife. Man, that's what I should be looking forward to all day. I should be running into my Savior's arms instead of thinking, oh man, I'm not quite good enough or I don't belong there.
That's great. So what would you say that our role in bringing our kids to Christ is?
Yeah, that's a great question. That's a great question. And I look at Deuteronomy 7. Deuteronomy 7 is a great passage where it talks to parents and about our responsibility for children. It says, as we go about our way, as we lay down, as we get up, as we go about our day, we should be reminding our children and teaching them the ways of God and the ways of Christ. And so for us as parents, these conversations, this is not a one-time conversation.
Right.
So I've got a teenage daughter right now. I've got two preteens. And so one of the big things in my family right now is like, all right, when are we having like the sex conversations and the conversations about like, you know, propriety and, you know, how far is too far in a dating relationship? When should I date? When shouldn't I date?
Yeah.
And a lot of times parents view those as like, that's like a one. Have you had the birds and the bees? Have you had the one conversation? And a lot of times our parents will, and I'm sure that's a whole nother podcast, but that's where we'll have that. Oh, I had that one conversation and we think we're good. But no, gospel conversation, it's a series of conversations. It's a lifestyle. It's as certain things come across your path, it's tying that back to the gospel. And so you see something happen. Maybe we do this in our family a lot where we'll see an emergency vehicle. You see an ambulance or a fire truck as we're heading to school or something. And we'll say, hey, can we just stop and pray for that family, whoever it is, because they're experiencing something right now that's really scary. And if they don't have Jesus, they're going to need him. And if they do have them, if they do have Jesus, they really need to lean on him right now. So can we just have that conversation and stuff? And it, what it does is now my children, even my five-year-old, he'll say, sometimes we'll see it. He'll see the ambulance before we do. He's like, we need to pray. You know, and it creates this urgency for the gospel that, hey, this is something that's mindset. So those little things, finding things out as you go about your day and those conversations, it's not like my kid is 6 years old. He's finally reached the age of accountability. And so now I can start having to, I can tell the gospel.
Yeah.
Right. Even from when they're in the womb all the way up, it's a series of conversations.
Yeah. But would you say that looks different? Like when they're like, I mean, of course it will look different, but like how, like what would that look like differently as they're going through those stages? So like, you know, an infant, you're not going to say, all right, let me lay out the Romans road for you right now. Right. You know, they're like, man, what a bottle. Like what?
That would be freaky.
Oh man, they get their communication across though. So what would be like for practically for a person who, you know, maybe they're a first time parent, their kids are still infants. What does that look like, you know, maybe for them? And what is the parent's role in that time?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And I think, you know, for the three of us, we've had children. Jonathan, God hasn't blessed you yet, but we're praying for that. But the as we hold our infants, what do we want our infants to know? We want them to know, first off, we want them to know that mom and dad love you. Yeah. We want them to know that you're safe, that you're going to be cared for, that you're going to be loved. And so we as parents, we are the ones that God's placed on this earth to care for these children. And so in the early days, a lot of what our kids are learning about God, they're actually learning about the world. They're learning from us.
Yeah.
And so if while we are loving and nourishing and patient with our children, eventually they're going to relate that with God as well. And it's not confusing why God would use a parent to relate to humanity.
Right.
He's called our Father, you know, God our Father. And so for us dads, that's a huge responsibility that we refer to God as Father. And that means our children are learning about God first by learning from us.
Yeah.
So dads, what are you doing that's reflecting God? Or what aren't you doing? And what are some things? And moms, and I grew up as my parents got divorced when I was a preteen. And so a lot of times my mom had to fill that role. And so she had to be the one that was giving me the picture and giving me the structure and stuff like that. So I think at infants, it's more of how we're relating with them. But we can even be, you can be talking to them about the Bible stories. You can be singing hymns. You can be singing, you know, songs over them and things like that. And all that just grows into eventually when they do start understanding.
And I think instead of thinking of it both from, you know, in the infancy stage as well as they're growing up, instead of thinking about it as like a checklist or what do I need to do, it's more or like that burden that you have, this extra thing I need to teach my kids aside from eating properly and how to care for themselves and all of that.
Right.
This is actually you use this as a resource, right? We use the Bible and our relationship, our faith, to be how we relate to our children. So in that infancy stage, you're calling on that and they're seeing you pull your patience when it's really late at night and you're very tired and just don't want to get up another time. But you know that you need to show, you know, your child the love and care that they're requiring. So I think that really just transforming how we think about it and in our own responsibility is helpful.
That's so good. One thing I think of is, I can never lead someone further than I'm already going. It's considered the law of the lid. So as I raise my lid, now I can lead the people below me. It's a John Maxwell term. But so the idea is that if I want my child to be a mature disciple of Jesus, then I've got to make sure that I'm a mature disciple of Jesus.
Mm.
And so if I want my son to be patient, I've got to learn how to be patient. If I want my daughter to have self-control, I've got to have self-control. If I want anything in the people that I'm leading, if I want something from them or I want them to grow into something, I have to first grow there first. So as parents, you know, and I think you just said this so eloquently, that pulling on that patience, maybe instead of like pulling on our hair or something, and we're all going to have those stressful moments, right?
Yeah.
But it's how we respond in those stressful moments
where
our kids, and especially as they grow up and they're children and then they're preteens and then they're teenagers, the way we respond in our situations, they will learn so much from that.
I would respectfully also challenge that, because our children sometimes will call us out or we need to call ourselves out. And that has been pretty profound and remarkable for me in my faith and growing, you know, in Christ, was taking a step back and going, whoa, I handled that poorly. And going back to the kids and their offering their forgiveness to me for messing up and for not responding the right way. And so sometimes, you know, I look at things, well, they handled that really well. I, on the other hand, did not. And so you see the student surpassing the master, or whatever the phrase is.
Right.
There's some phrase there.
Well, and the great thing is that even, oh, go ahead.
No, but that's, you know, and I would say that even in our own household, as you know, is a house of newer faith. It was my daughter, my 3-year-old at the time, daughter, praying on her own before bed for my niece who has been battling cancer. And that was transformational for our family.
And I think that's exactly what Jesus was getting at when he said, your faith needs to be like this child's.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just what an incredible illustration you have in your own household there. And I think too, that for us to have a gospel centered home and gospel driven relationships is forgiveness, seeking forgiveness, and then also offering forgiveness has to be a part of that, because that's so central to the gospel theme. Is, you know, if I'm going to be a parent and I'm going to raise my child to understand and respect the gospel, then I also have to practice. That means when I mess up,
that's right,
I got to come back to whoever I messed up with, and I got to say, hey Gideon, hey Rocky, hey Jada, hey Boaz, you know, Dad was wrong. You know, I hold myself, God holds me to a standard, and I did not meet God's standard, and I was wrong. And so Dad apologizes for that, and I appreciate your patience. Would you forgive me? And having those conversations instead of hey, I'm the parent because I said so, you do it my way, this is my house, my rules.
Yeah.
No, it's just like we heard from Pastor this past week. This is actually God's house. It's all God.
That's right.
And so respecting and being good stewards of that. I love that illustration.
Oh my goodness. And that's, I love what you guys are saying there, because it's like, it's not a call to perfection. It's not a call to being a perfect parent. It's a call to being a gospel-filled parent and a gospel-centric parent. You know, with the idea that's like, you know, we are going to make mistakes. We are going to sin. You know, but when we do, it's about what do we do after that, you know, to show the truth of the gospel, even through our flaws. And that's the beautiful thing with Christ, is that even through our flaws, God shows his glory. And that's like really big thing in the gospel story.
So I'm sorry. You're good? Okay. So what are some times where we may not think that it's a good time to have a gospel conversation, but it actually ends up being the perfect time? Can you speak a little bit to that, either of you?
Well, I'll go first. Gabe, you're doing a great job.
Yeah, Gabe, I appreciate all the input you're giving me there. So
my pleasure.
I'll say sometimes the best time for a gospel conversation is when I don't want to have one. It is when it's late at night. I just want to get the kids in bed. I want to tuck them in. I want to say a prayer. I want to, you know, whatever your routine is, and put those kids to bed because I am worn out, right? And then my kids are, hey, Dad, what does, and then they have some random question, you know, what happens when you die? Or what is, you know, when Jesus died and before he rose again, those three, we just had, you know, we're preparing for Easter here. When Jesus was in the grave, what was his mind doing? Was he just like turned off or what? And we have these conversations.
We had a similar question the other day in our house. I was like, oh, we got to dive into this. Yeah.
And I don't know if I have a great answer.
Right, right.
But this is when those conversations, you're not quite ready for it. And you're just not quite. And it's like, oh, well, and you just get a quick answer and you move on. You know, you kind of want to like get them to be quiet so you can do your thing or whatever. Come on, man. We got Netflix to catch up. So, but here's the thing is, to be ready. And I think the Bible teaches that as well, as like, hey, in season and out of season, be ready to give a defense for your faith. That's not just talking about against Satan or the enemies, or not just talking about against the atheists that you go to work with or that you're in math class with. No, it's even talking about our own children.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, we need to be ready at all times to have these conversations, because you never know. You never know, first off, and this is a reality of our world, you never know when the last conversation you're going to have with your child is. You just never know. I have sat with many parents and they've always said, when they lost a child, they said, I just didn't know. I didn't know that was going to be my last conversation. I didn't know this was going to be the last time I see them. And we're talking about young children. We're talking about teenage children, adult children. You just don't know. And so being ready all the time to have that conversation, I think too, just understanding that in the thick of it, it is our responsibility as parents to be discipling our children and leading them to Jesus. It is our children's responsibility to make the decision to follow Jesus. We cannot make our decision. We cannot make that decision for our children. That is their decision. And as we go through scripture, we see so many times where the opportunity was there and people did not make the decision. And that's, while that's sad and that's tragic, that's a reality.
It's also life-giving in a way, right? It relieves us of a burden of something that we ultimately will not be able to control, and we should not try. Although we do have the responsibility of trying, right? So we don't have to feel like we are, and it's the same way with family members and brothers and sisters and all of that. That was something that I had to kind of come to terms with, where it's just, you know, you can only be the example and try, but ultimately their salvation doesn't rest on your shoulders.
No, that's so good.
And I found that, you know, as a parent, you have to have this gospel lens. I call it the gospel lens, right? To view those gospel opportunities And oftentimes, in my experience, not only as a pastor, but also as a parent, is, man, those moments whenever forgiveness becomes very real, when your child does something he shouldn't have done. You know, you told him not to get the cookie, and he decides to, in essence, obey his own desires and take the cookie, although you told him not to do so. So typically, you know, our response is to be responsive, right? Just react in the moment. And what if we had lenses in which we view those opportunities as, well, guess what? Perfect timing. We talk about obedience, talk about forgiveness. That it doesn't mean that there won't be consequences. There are very real consequences to your actions. But at the same time, in the scheme of eternity, Jesus gives us freedom that it is to be with him and forgive us. So I found oftentimes as a marker for me to keep, by the way, just being transparent, to keep myself in check and accountable, to say, you know what? Don't react. I know you really want to react. And look, I've made multiple mistakes because I am a reactive person. But having the thought in my mind constantly of, I need to be ready 24/7 to have gospel conversations with all the daily interruptions that God has presented to me. My kid disobeying, my kid having good grades, my kid's having bad grades, my kid responding to my wife when he should have talked back, right? There's just so many. If we stop to think about it, there are so many gospel opportunities. The fact that you're walking out the door, you woke up this morning, the breath of life has been given to you today. Not everybody got that. And you did. What a blessing, what a gift it is from God. So just, I think for me, again, just having the lenses to view everything in life as a gospel opportunity is helpful for discipling and having gospel conversation with our children, but at the same time, keeping each other accountable as well.
Yeah, and you used the phrase daily interruptions, and really looking at that to what you said later were gospel opportunities. So it really, you think about it as daily opportunities, right? Because the interruptions are guaranteed. They're going to happen constantly and generally when you don't need them to happen or when you feel like you don't. So I'm going to read from Priscilla Schurer, this lovely quote: God is the God of right now. He doesn't want you sitting around regretting yesterday, nor does he want you wringing your hands and worrying about the future. He wants you focusing on what he is saying to you and putting in front of you right now. So we've talked about making mistakes, and I think we all would raise our hand. We've all made plenty of mistakes, and guess what? We'll continue to make them. And listeners.
Oh, man. I thought one of these days I could get to a point, no more mistakes.
No.
I'd be fine.
No, it's not. We are told, we know that we.
I feel like Josh is there, you know? Like, I've never seen him.
No.
So,
nope.
He's a boss, so we have to say nice.
So thinking about how we can keep the bigger picture in mind and not allowing past mistakes to haunt us when it comes to teaching our kids about the gospel. I think I could sit in a room and just bawl thinking about all the times that I failed my kids and all the times that I failed God when I was reacting to my kids. And that's like a double whammy. But let's not lament and not think about all those failures, but use them to be, you know, into the future. So if you'd like to speak on that a little bit.
100%. So as you're speaking, the thought comes to my head is that while our failures and our shortcomings, we're not proud of them, and we don't want to, we definitely want to repeat them. We didn't want to do them the first time. None of them are surprises to God. And God makes it very clear in his word that he works all things together for good. That includes our mess ups. That includes our mistakes, our shortcomings, our sin. He works them all together for good for those who love God or called according to his purpose. And
so it
puts the emphasis on my heart. Like, where's my heart? And is my heart in a good place? Is my heart in a condition to where God can say, you know what? Josh made a mistake there. Josh messed up, but I can still bless him because I know that his heart is in a place where he's wanting to serve others. He's wanting to love others. He's wanting to bring glory to me. Versus if my heart is in a very selfish place, if my heart is in a place where I want to be the authority, I want to be the one that's in control of things. Well, now God's like, hey, Josh, you messed up, but your heart is in a place where if I use that, or if I kind of work around that mess up and still bring blessing into your life, you're going to think that blessing is because of you. And if you think the blessing is because of you, then that's just going to re-emphasize where your heart is right now. And I can't bless that. So I have to bring correction, or I have to bring discipline to bring your heart back to a place where I can bless. And so for us as parents, it's not about being perfect, but it is about guarding our heart. Mm-hmm. It is about continuing to put ourselves in a place where, all right, God, what in me do you want to change? And surrender to ourselves. And honestly, that's a daily thing. It's a weekly thing. It's a habit. It's something that we just constantly should be looking at. All right, God, what is the something in me that you want to change? The other thing is, I think it's important for us to do, and this is kind of a little bit of a sidestep here, but we've used this phrase gospel conversations and gospel-centered homes. I think it's important for us to define what is the gospel, so many times we in Christianity, we have words that we throw around and stuff, and right. A lot of people could take the gospel and just say, well, hey, what I just said, they might think that's the gospel. As long as your heart's in the right place, and as long as you're trying to be gospel-minded and love others, then you're good. But the gospel is something very specific. It is the fact that we are all sinners. Christ, in his love for us, did not want to leave us in our sin, destined for hell, destined for death, but instead he stepped out of heaven. He became a man. He lived a sinless life. He died on the cross. 3 days later, he rose again, conquering death, sin, hell itself, and paying the price for not just his death, but paying the price for our sin and the sin of the world. So John 3:16, anyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That is the gospel. And I can love my kids. I can cherish my kids. I can forgive my kids. I can encourage them. But if I don't introduce them to the gospel, then I've done them a disservice. If the only time they hear the gospel is when they go to an evangelism camp, in youth group, or if they go to church and they hear from the pastor or something, then I, as a parent, if I've never verbalized that gospel to them of, hey, this is the most important thing. Now, when does that conversation happen, and how do you have that happen? It happens on a constant basis, and we're constantly reminding ourselves, hey, you know, mom and dad, we sinned, but hey, Jesus forgave us. I need you to forgive me. And that's the gospel, mm-hmm. right? And so it's having those conversations, but also having that clarity that the gospel is not this wide thing that we can adapt it into whatever we want. No, it is this very precise thing that God's given us. And now it is so maneuverable. It's applicable in every area. So we can apply it in every area, but it is very precise. It is that Jesus died for the world, and apart from sin, or apart from faith in him, we cannot have forgiveness of sin. And so that's important for us to have. But it's also one of those things that, man, we have to be living for those opportunities.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those opportunities is when you're going to have time to insert that truth.
So how do you assess whether or not, like, what's a good way of assessing whether or not you're having these conversations in your home, or that you're prioritizing this?
Ms. Aaron, can I step in real fast? I've got an awesome story for our families. And
Sweet. And
this is something that happened just this past week before we're filming this. And so basically, you know, a few podcasts ago, I told you that there was one of our preteens that came, you know, talked to his leaders and said, you know, yeah, me and my dad is really starting to get into the Bible, and I see him read it, and that, you know, that's really awesome. You know, I really want to do that. How do I do that? You know, I talked to him later. He didn't even know that his son was interested or even knew that he was reading the Bible. But he was watching them. So yeah, we talked about that in our last podcast. If you haven't watched that, make sure you go ahead and watch that. That was episode
It was four.
Yeah. But anyways, this past week, I had a chance to meet with this kid and his dad. And, you know, the kid asked me, he was like, you know, I'm ready to be saved. And he's a super shy kid, so he doesn't say much at all. So we're working through the salvation plan and everything, and I'm talking to him about what it means to be a sinner, and you know, he's kind of getting it. And then eventually, you know, he's like, I'm ready to pray. And I said, okay, buddy, well, you want to pray? And he prays, he bows his head, he's like, dear God. And I look up, and there's just these tears just like rolling down his cheek. And his dad has his hand on his back. It's just tears rolling down his cheek. And he's like, God, Pastor Jonathan, I don't know what to say next. And then I was like, it's okay, buddy. It's okay. And I'm bawling. And I walk him through the salvation, you know, and he's like, I know what I want to say. I just can't say it. You know, and so we work through it. And afterwards, he's crying and such a strong man, you know, and he's so excited. And he's like, well, when can I get baptized? You know, and I said, well, we can get baptized just as soon as, you know, your parents say we're good to go. So we got the baptism scheduled and everything. And that right there is what we're talking about.
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about. That dad didn't even know that what he was doing by opening his Bible, reading his Bible, and his kid catching him reading his Bible, he didn't know exactly what impact that would have in his family's life. But because of that, and the Lord using that, the kid is now in fellowship with Christ. He's saved from his sins. And man, that kid, it was so genuine. It was so genuine. There was no doubt in my mind that he made that decision right then and right there. And that's what happens when we have those intentional gospel conversations.
Well, and we see the beauty of our faithfulness.
Yeah. Right.
You know, kind of going a little bit with that and what Ms. Erin had asked, the beauty is at the end of the day, it is the work of the Holy Spirit. That's doing the work.
Mm.
Our responsibility, the imperative, is for us to be obedient, to be faithful.
Right.
So here we have a dad who's been faithful to follow Jesus.
Yeah.
He doesn't even know that because he's following Jesus, God, through the Holy Spirit, is using that
right
to reach his own kid.
Right.
And now not only is that child his son, but that is also his brother in Christ.
Wow.
And one day they'll be together and celebrate the beauty that it is to praise the name of Jesus. And I want to encourage parents as well that, and we alluded to this about this often in our podcast, but we just believe it's important that at the end of the day, man, it's our own relationship where it starts. It's about our own faithfulness that gives us those rhythms that often our children will see. And, you know, we can talk about the age, you know, what is the perfect age? And I think at different ages, there's different opportunities that we can have different conversations that can be heavier on one side and the other. But what if you start by just showing the gospel? Now, the gospel right. has to be proclaimed. Don't get me wrong. That's what the Bible does say. But what if, you know, our children, when they're born, we show them love, protection, like Pastor Josh said, and as they grow up, they see us to read scripture and to do it in ways where they see us, but then also in ways where they don't see us. At least we think they don't see us, right? Mm-hmm. And it is those type of actions that often God will use to speak life into our children.
And by contrast, they're also watching when we're not, right? And if we're talking to our spouse in a not good manner or not, you know, being kind to one another, to other adults, if you're having, you know, an issue with a cashier somewhere, they're watching all of that and absorbing that. So not being blind to the fact that we should, you know, they're only listening when we're talking directly to them. Sometimes they're not listening because we're talking directly to them and they're listening more or watching more or looking over your shoulder at what you're doing on your phone or whatever else. So understanding that they're watching always and so is God.
That's so good. And, you know, the lunch table on Sunday afternoon. Hey, what'd you think of the pastor's sermon? Well, I don't know. He wasn't quite on this week or, you know, that illustration didn't quite go or pastor was good, but I don't know what the band was doing, you know. All that criticism that we as adults sometimes we kind of like throw that around and we understand, hey, we all love Pastor Zach, we all love Miss Jennifer or John or whatever. But our kids, they take that and be like, hey, dad's kind of critical or mom's kind of critical of church or Pastor Jonathan or whatever. And not to say that we're above criticism. Come on, y'all come criticize me all the time. You follow me around, you're going to find plenty of stuff criticized, right? But it's that. That mindset and that heart of no, this is something that represents Christ to our children, and so we got to protect that. You know, I think of it too as we talk about in culture. A lot of times in Christian culture, you might be critical of like a Christian artist or of another church or another pastor, maybe a well-known pastor, and you might be like, oh yeah, da 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 da. Well, our kids, they might be like, yeah, but that's a pastor. Why would mom talk about a pastor like that? Why would dad talk about a pastor like that? Because to them, that's a representation of Christ as well. So we gotta protect those things. One thing, Miss Erin, you asked me about like those opportune times, those times for those opportunities. I'll share a story from just this last year. So as functioning youth pastor before Pastor Gabe got here, was with the students at camp, summer camp, Super Summer. By the way, if you haven't gotten signed up, get signed up.
Kids too.
That's right. Kids camp as well. But we were down at Lake Yale and having our Super Summer youth camp. And just a beautiful night. It was an amazing night. And I'm not talking about the weather. The weather was great too, but just God was on fire working in our kids' hearts. We had multiple students place their faith in Jesus, including one guy that, you know, people have been praying for this guy for years and years. And honestly, I was this close to kicking him out of camp. I was ready to send him home. And I said, but you know what, God, we're going to give you, I wasn't giving him one more night. I was giving God one more night. And God met with that kid and just radically saved him. It was amazing. We've seen fruit since then. It's just amazing, right?
Wow.
My own daughter comes to me and that night and she's like, Dad, I've got questions about my salvation. My daughter, she was saved when she was 4 years old. And I baptized her when she was six. And the reason I baptized her, I waited because I wanted to make sure this was a true decision, right?
Right.
At 4 years old, I mean, man, I've got a son right now at 5 years old, and he doesn't understand the gospel. At 4 years old, I had big questions if she understood the gospel. At 6 years old, she literally sat me down and she said, Dad, when are you going to let me get baptized? And I'm like, well, I mean, talk to me about why you want to get baptized. And she had all the right answers. And eventually she said, Dad, you're causing me to not be able to grow in my faith because of what I want to do for Jesus by getting baptized, because I want to show the world what God's already done in my heart at 6 years old. And so I'm like, okay, fine, I'll let you get baptized enough, right? And I had a beautiful opportunity. Well, she comes to me that night at 13 and she's like, hey, I've got these questions and stuff. So I'm talking with her about it. It's just a real beautiful night. 1 a.m., I get back to my room. And now as functioning youth pastor, there's a little bit of a little perk there. I brought my two boys, my two preteens to youth camp. They love it. They get to play gaga ball, right? Boaz is sitting straight up in his bed and he says, Dad, I need to talk to you. It's 1 a.m. I've just gone through one of the most emotional nights of a youth pastor's life, right? Why aren't you in bed, Boaz? Well, technically he wasn't in bed. He was sitting in bed. He's like, I'm right where you told me to go. So you told me to go and I went and I've been sitting here ever since. And he goes, I think I need to be saved. 1 a.m. at youth camp. I'm there for the teenagers, right? Wow. And here's what God's doing in my son's heart at 10 years old, what God's doing in his heart right there. And he had made a previous decision for Christ before and he'd already been baptized. And but he just kind of, so we just kind of talked through it. And instead of me reminding him and said, yeah, but remember when you were at church and you got saved and then you got baptized, we've already done this. I just, well, what are you thinking? Well, what do you think about this? And I asked a lot of questions. I let him tell the story. Right. Why did I let him tell the story? Because it's his story. I'm privileged. I get to be a part of it, right? But it's his story. And so that's just one of those things. And it was a beautiful moment. And he basically said that, you know, when he was younger, he was just trying to make some people happy, including me. But now that he just really realized that this is what he needed. And in his life, even since that moment, I've seen fruit in his life that I didn't see before. Yeah. And that's one of those things where you got to be ready. And when the opportunity is there, I'm telling you, Mom, I'm telling you, Dad, that's the most important conversation you'll ever have. It doesn't matter how tired you are, how hard your day was. Stop and have the conversation. You'll never regret it.
Beautiful. Thank you so much.
That's so awesome.
Well, it's been a wonderful, wonderful having this conversation. Thank you so much for sharing and for being here, Pastor Josh. Thank you to all our listeners. We really appreciate you chiming in here and listening. We want to continue these podcasts and talking about the things that are relevant to you and what could be helpful. I can't think of a more important topic as a parent to go through and to talk through. Mm-hmm.
And parents, if you guys, you know, found this content helpful, please share it, you know, with other parents, because there might be parents just like you that are like, man, I would really love to hear somebody talk about this. You know, let's just open this conversation. Let's talk about it. Please share this with your friends. And because we're praying that as we continue this podcast, we're continuing to equip families to navigate life with God's truth. Thank you again, Pastor Josh, for being on the podcast. You're awesome. We love you, man. And Gabe, thank you for your input as well.
Papa's.
All right, we'll see you guys next month on the podcast. Bye.
Thank you. Yeah.